maybe 518. Okay, 518. Look at 14. If any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. I would say that would be a prayer of agreement right there. And then it jumps to verse 15, and the prayer of faith should save the sick. And the prayer of faith should save the sick. And the Lord shall raise him up if he have committed sins that should be forgiven him. So this seems to be in a body, a corporate body, assembly. Because going with verse 13, any sick among you, or is any among you afflicted, let him pray. Is any married, let him sing songs. Is any sick among you, let him call for the elders and let them pray.
And let them pray.
Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick. So that's why I got to ask the author to do that. I asked him if I can remember. But pretty much we can agree on the prayer of faith for you, Mark 11, 23, 24. That's whatever thing you desire is you pray. Whatever you can believe for, hold that confession of faith about, more power to you. Now, if you can get someone to agree with you on what you desire, then that's even better. That's good. Because if anything on earth, so that's the prayer of agreement. I can agree about you, and you know, I couldn't get nobody to agree with me in my Rolls Royce last week, so I just do it on my own.
We didn't disagree.
My faith's good enough. So I'm standing on my own. So, but I can get somebody to agree with me. I'll agree with you. Mm-hmm. So, two, be done.
It's done.
Okay, so that's that. Now, that was real quick observation on something we learned last week. Today is going to get very, very heavy. Y'all ready?
We're ready.
Got your spiritual hats on? Strapped in? All right, here we go. I think it's going to start on page 11, I think, maybe 10, maybe 9.
Nine,
okay. All right. Praying with all prayer. A couple of verses in Ephesians, praying with all prayer, supplication in the Spirit. And the key words we want to deal with tonight is the word of supplication. We want to define supplication. What is supplication? And here it says, supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. So we had supplication there twice, supplication in the Spirit and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. And then we see supplication again in Philippians. The writers, same author, Paul, he says, be careful for nothing, but everything by prayer, in addition to prayer, supplication. So these are two distinct realities, prayer and supplication. Supplication with thanksgiving. All right, then he shoots down again, 1 Timothy, same author. Paul says, I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers. So supplication is different from prayer. Can't define it the same way. Supplication, prayer, intercessions. Intercessions has his own definition. And giving of thanks be made for all men. Kings that are in authority, they may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. This is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth. So before we get into any of our questions, I think if we just exhaust these three verses, we'll have answers to most of the questions that he's got in the back, since he didn't have a cheat sheet. If I know now, I wouldn't have thought to do it.
That's amazing, man.
All right. And anybody, can I challenge you to tell me what definition, supplication, commentary?
Right on page 9 at the bottom.
Okay.
It's a request made in a humble, heartfelt, and fervent manner.
Okay. Mm-hmm. It's a humble, heartfelt, fervent prayer. Humble, heartfelt, fervent prayer. Now, if I have my own personal sins that I need forgiveness for and I'm going to repent over, should I bring it to the corporate body and do as the description of fervent, I'm kind of jumped ahead of myself. I better stay, we said a supplication first. Mm-hmm. Supplication for all saints. Sister Hill, you said it was a humble, heartfelt.
Yeah, fervent.
Fervent.
Fervent, yes.
Okay. Can't so, mm-hmm. And the scripture says up here in Ephesians, Philippians, that it should be made on behalf of who? Mm-hmm. Of yourself or on behalf of others?
Yourself and others.
Yourself and others.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now, I just say, okay, I see Wayne over there. Lord bless Wayne today. Amen. Was that supplication?
No.
What was missing?
Heartfelt, fervent.
It wasn't heartfelt?
No.
Fervent?
No, it wasn't fervent.
Right. It wasn't fervent either?
Lazy.
Tough bunch tonight, I tell you. God bless you.
I wasn't in trouble at that time, hopefully.
Good, well, you already saved, huh? Good thing he's already saved from the Holy Ghost. But so the author here says that's how most believers pray. And we wonder why we don't get an answer to prayer, because it's not what? Heartfelt. So, fervent. You might hear Jessica's testimony from this week.
Jessica, your daughter,
Jessica? No. I don't want to poop out my thunder. But maybe she'll get it.
And maybe she won't, so you tell her. She wanted to see you.
I bet
she
did.
Put on the program for the fifth Sunday, let her give it.
Yeah.
He can't wait. He's
angry. But let's just say like this: if she would have got injured yesterday, what would be the difference between the way I just prayed for Wayne and the way that I would be praying for her?
If she had gotten
injured,
it would be very fervent. Very fervent. I mean, yeah.
Tears.
Absolutely.
Yes. Agony. Mm-hmm. Losing sleep. Mm-hmm. Definitely heartfelt.
Exactly.
And definitely making a request on God's behalf. That's what you call supplication. And maybe that's what you call fervent.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, definitely fervent.
But now, supplication is on the behalf of somebody else. With that fervency behind it. So this is what Paul requested. That in praying, Ephesians 6:18, praying always, how often? Always. Mm-hmm. All prayer and supplication, how? In the Spirit. So we should never pray a heartfelt, heartless, lazy prayer. Ooh, man. Then that should be the business of the church then. How many came up in holiness churches? Sister Pearl, Sister, over there.
Well, actually,
is that how? What's the difference between the way that y'all was brought up and the way that most most church services, prayer services are today.
Say that again.
What's the difference between current day prayer sessions and prayer sessions back in that day?
Oh, that was a lot more.
It was a what?
It's the same with me.
Same with you?
Both about the same.
About the same.
That's me. That's how I feel about it.
You mean in terms of your personal?
Actually praying.
Yeah, right, right.
You're actually praying too.
But are you talking about the corporate body?
The corporate.
Your corporate body?
Yeah.
So those old mothers wouldn't pray.
They were.
So no mother wouldn't pray?
No, they were not playing.
I used to live on.
And they knew how to reach the throne.
They sure did.
I used to live on the 1300 block of North Lansing growing up as a kid. And my house would happen to be next door to a church, in a church across the street. And I was just a little nappy head boy, but I could always tell when they was in there. It was noisy. And then I used to live across the street from a lady that I thought was a witch, because come to find out, she was praying in the spirit. And she was very, very loud. She was inside her house, and you could hear her, and well, I just thought she was a witch, you know, and when she'd come out and look at her, stay away from her and all like that. But that's why I got saved and figured out what was going on. She was full of the Holy Ghost. So you don't find that in too many churches today. You really don't. Well, I think if I go over, be careful for nothing, he says, but everything by everything, but in everything, prayer and supplication. All right. Then Timothy says, he says in Timothy, I exhort therefore, first of all, again, supplications. That's some on behalf of others, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. All right, now, let's flip on over to our next page here, page 10. It says supplications should be made for ourselves concerning our material, physical, and spiritual needs. Anybody got Philippians 4:6, you can give us what that verse says. But supplication should be made on our own behalf.
4:6. It's on the first page.
Oh, is it? Okay, what did it say there?
Be careful for nothing.
Okay.
But in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving.
Okay.
Let your requests be made known unto God.
Okay.
And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Okay. Okay. That's Philippians 4:6.
Oh, Philippians, what did you want? You said Ephesians.
Yeah, let's look at Philippians.
I am so sorry. Yeah, I'm reading Philippians.
Be careful for what? Nothing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, let your requests be made. The first area where people lose out in that prayer request right there is that they go into prayer worrying. A situation arrives, and the first order of business is to worry. And to fret and to get anxious and all out of whack. And that's what drove them into prayer. Instead of knowing that as soon as I get into his presence, I'm going to get my answer and get some help. But it's pretty much the anxiety of the situation that drives a person into prayer. For a nation or a corporation, what have you, for example, 9/11. So many people got saved on 9/11. Went to church the first opportunity. All night services and all night prayer. That situation drove people to it. And there's a good and there's a bad to that. The bad is that's what drove you into God's presence. That negative circumstance. Instead of getting into God's presence anyway. And making requests just because of who he is. So, it's a lot of people that say, well, 9/11 or so, going to church and all like that for the full week or two.
It's true.
That's the way to go. And when you talk about the fervency, I mean, isn't it?
They did have fervency.
Through the trials that we have fervency and that we go into prayer with?
Is it the trials that drive you to fervency?
Yes.
Fervency?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
They can, absolutely.
I mean, you've got to have, I mean, for fervency to be passionate, mm-hmm. you've got to have some push in that. Mm-hmm. It just don't, you just don't, just like you prayed for Brother Wayne a while ago. Mm-hmm. There was no fervency there because there was no passion behind it.
Wayne, that was
the but you have some drama in your life. You get into some drama. You get into some drama and you need some help.
Okay.
I'll tell
that
you.
Fervency.
Yeah, so I see where you're coming from.
Yeah, like the lady, I don't know who saw it. The Malaysian paint plane, the
movie
today,
yeah.
all out because she said she wanted her son. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know if she was praying, but there was some fervent, there was a real need there. Yeah. That woman was exactly. crying out.
Yeah.
I mean, think about the city that Paul then may have wrote these letters in.
Okay.
I mean, it wasn't an easy walk for Christians back then in this time.
And it wasn't for
Paul.
I'm trying to get you
to
agree.
Well, I want you. I mean, their fervency.
I'm going to give you my commentary.
Okay. I would say because of the era, their fervency was pretty high. Because they were faced with
because
a lot
of
difficulties.
Circumstances
right.
and situations and the hurt
yes.
and all of this and all that. Okay, go ahead, sister.
I'm just going to say there's a difference in you have a relationship already.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have to agree with Brother Oman. After you got your relationship,
okay,
now you can go to him now because mm-hmm. you got a real need.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But there's that relationship first. I think there's two mm-hmm. things going
intersecting.
Yeah.
Hey, first, what was that he says, praying for those in authority? 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 4.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 4. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for who are all men, then you characterize what he's talking about. Kings, everybody in authority, mm-hmm. that we might lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty. Mm-hmm. This is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. So, if the king is real nice to us, and he's not overtaxing, overburdening us, and doing all kinds of problems like the Egyptian king was doing to the children of Israel, and your cry came up to the Lord. Mm-hmm. And here we're saying that if the king is good to us and he's not causing us any pain, we'll pray a little different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It won't be that same agonizing. Right. Right. And that's not what the Lord is saying. He's saying pour it out all the time.
Yeah.
Pour it. That heartfelt, that burning, that getting, you know, the depth of your soul praying for that king and those in authority and those kind of people, he says, do it all the time. Not just when there's a pain, something that might drive you to do that.
Okay, well, that's going to bring me to a question. How do you create fervency then?
Yeah.
How do you create it?
No. I don't get paid.
No. Come on. I mean, come on, doctor. You got to tell me. How do you create this fervency that the Bible is
supposed to create? I'm going to show you. I'm going to tell you. That's a good question. That's come at the end of the lesson, but
okay.
I'll go ahead. We'll go ahead and do it now.
Okay.
What's going out there?
Because this is pretty
Pastor
deep.
Hill says it all the time.
But sometimes, you know, like what you say with your daughter, I believe that you would have fervency with that prayer because you have a relationship with her.
Sure. That's an emotional attachment.
Yeah. That's a part of it. Yeah.
But that don't make me, I mean, do I go before the Father like that always? Does the Bible say go before me like that always?
Yes.
That's what he said.
But that's what I'm saying. How do you do that?
Always. He said, oh, and every time, and here, you see it. Didn't he say that?
Yeah.
Philippians 4:6. But in everything by prayer First Timothy 2, first of all supplications and prayers. Anytime you do it, he seems to be saying here, anytime you go into prayer, it should be with fervency. Supplication for somebody else, giving it your all, heartfelt. So, yeah. Now, the question Brother had is that, how do you create that? Because some days, you're human, and you just don't feel like, it's like a ball player, you know, some days he's on, some days he's not. Babe Ruth, he hit a home run every time he swung. He struck out more. So how do you get on your game and have him stay on your game? Or how do you get on your game? Pastor Hill has the best answer that I know of. Fast. And he said they had a fasted life. Tuesday and Friday, I'm so glad I waited until. Glad I didn't need to. All my fun.
I guess like the story of Esther, you know, the story of Esther when Mordecai had she fasted because they was killing her, so we'll kill her.
Now, those situations will drive you in there. Yeah. Right. Situations that drive
that's
you.
That's afflicting
in
your soul.
There's no doubt about it.
Afflicting your soul.
Yeah, those situations are struggling.
See, but look what it's doing, though. I mean, you're creating an affliction in your soul.
Yeah.
That's
something that who's doing it? Who's
right.
doing it?
You are. But you're creating that fervency.
You're creating that what you need.
That's one way to do it.
That's one. You're creating that what you need.
But it's painful.
Sure.
See, that's what I'm trying to associate. It's to get fervency and to get compassion with something. There has to be something that would compel
you
in there. Where it has to be intense.
Where God wants you, that intensity, then you might have to go into a fast.
Right.
And I think to your point, when you said that, you know, some days when you don't feel like it, you do it anyway.
Yeah.
And you do it anyway. You keep going anyway. And gradually you'll get into it, and you will get fervent about it.
You become accustomed to it. This is how I have to pray. Yeah. You become accustomed to it. Yeah. But some days you're just not on your game. That's the best I can describe. Some days, you know, you can't hit a free throw. You can't hit a home run. What's going on? Well, you got to dig deeper. Yeah. You know, how do you do that? Well, you might have to fast. And Isaiah 58 says it's something that you do. It's, you know, he's showing you this is how God says you get there. And so why did Daniel go into fasting? When our lesson, I think one of the key verses of our lesson today is Daniel 9:2. Why couldn't Daniel just pick up the book of Jeremiah and read it, which is what he did, and he read it. He could have just put it down and said, okay, I got it. He said, this is not something. So to get that revelation, he had to dig deep, go deep, or whatever you might say. And he went into fasting. And people avoid a fast like the plague. Not this church, but they don't want that uncomfortableness to drive them to it. Whoa. Okay, all right. Can we go back to page 10 now? Okay. Now, another reason, another time to use supplications. And we understood what supplications was, is when you, like Matthew 9:37-38, is to get the work of the Lord done. You can't get it done by yourself, so you need help. And you know that the Lord's work needs more workers, or the church needs more people, or what have you. Then you have to do that, bring it up to that level to get that to happen. For example, praying for a revival meeting. Praying for America. How intense should we get to pray for America?
Very.
Have we even got serious with God yet about the direction of America? Well, bring it out to the national level, the state, Oklahoma. Bring it off the state to North Tulsa.
Maybe Republicans.
Okay, Chicago goes to hell on a handbag.
Speaking of praying for America, who ever thought that...
Is that a scratch?
No scratch there. You're right. Who would have thought? Now, who's responsible for us getting that bad? Who's responsible for us getting as bad as it is today? In our community, even all the way up to the national level. Who should have got in the way?
That's the wax in the people's hearts being cold.
Yeah. Okay, that's so what the church says.
No, it's prophesied, though.
It is prophesied.
We're about to look at Daniel's prayer. So look at what Daniel said, 9 and 2. I got me jumping all over this mess.
But if you go to Revelation, though, Pastor Williams, you can't.
We want to take it off us.
No.
What did Daniel say? What did Daniel do?
That's right.
We're like Daniel in verse 2. We see all this happening. Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, yeah, we can almost prophesy the entire time. We see it. So let's see what Daniel did. Okay, in the first year of Darius, the son of, Ahasuerus.
You're on
page 10. Under B, item 3.
Oh, okay.
And of the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans. In the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood how, by books, the number of the years, where the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, the prophet. So Daniel was studying Jeremiah. And then I understood by Jeremiah's writings, that he would accomplish 7 years in the desolation of Jerusalem. Now, and so Daniel said in verse 3, he says, what did he do?
Set my face forward and pray.
And he wanted to find out. He says, now I got some information from Jeremiah. That you're going to, it's going to be 70 prophetic years. And then he says, I need to know more. And as for him to know more, he says, the only way for me to know more is that I got to go into what? Supplications and prayers. The Hebrew people, it's not like Daniel was blind and didn't see what was going on. He knew that their state and status and relationship with the Lord. And as you see the rest of his prayer, but I think we're going to be into, we saw verse 3, look at verse 17 and 18. Daniel sees the state that his people is in, and he says, now therefore, O our God, hear the prayer of thy servant and his what?
Supplications.
And cause thy face to shine upon thy sanctuary that is desolate for the Lord's sake. Oh my God. You know, he's really, oh God, because he is getting revelation of how God is going to end this whole deal. Incline thy ear and hear. Now, part of supplication is making a strong demand on the throne of God. Daniel is not saying, hear me, God, this is your will. He said, no, listen to me. Listen to me. And so when you go into intercessions, just like Abraham was interceding for Lot, Abraham was, he said, hey, I'm stepping out here. And you got to deal, negotiate, and talk with me about what you getting ready to do. Because, you know, Abraham's back of his mind, he was saying, how many righteous people, I got a lot of kids, how many? He was going to tell God, hold up here, buddy. So how many we go in front of God and say, hey, hey, and really, he said, hey, look, what's up here? So he said in verse 18, oh my God, incline thine ear and hear, open whose eyes?
Thine eyes,
and look what we are. And the city that is called by thy name, for we do not present our supplications before thee for our righteousness, but for thy great mercy. And somewhere, it's in verse 20, he says, and while I was speaking and praying and confessing whose sin? And the sin of who?
My people.
Yeah, so do America, church world, do we say how bad we messed up when we go in front of God?
No, generally not.
We all right.
Yeah. And that's what he was saying in verse 18.
Mm-hmm.
His supplications before thee, for our righteousness, but for thy. Yeah. I'm coming for mercy, not because I'm so
I'm coming for mercy.
For mercy.
Something happened to America. You think we're just gonna get those bad folks?
No.
Something happened and turned our economy upside down. How many of us might be losing jobs, losing income opportunities, losing this thing? If they took away the America, the land of opportunity, that's what it is—the land of opportunity. Putin come over and say, hey, ain't no more land of opportunity. You know how people like that these days just come over and take over stuff? Yeah, that spirit is for real. If he can find a way to do it, he'll do it. Now you all work for me, Putin. My name is Putin. No more land of opportunity. I don't care how smart you are, how much you dream hard at that, don't make no difference. How would that affect us?
Riots.
You think it'd be riots?
Mm-hmm. Killing men.
Turn America upside down.
Mm-hmm. The NFL?
Tear it up. And as you look back through the history of America, the only way we came out of our mess, I'm talking all the way from slavery, the Civil War, and all like that, is because somebody got to pray.
Somebody got to pray. That's right.
Somebody got to pray. And think about it, it's the only way you got saved, too.
That's it.
Somebody prayed for you.
Somebody got to pray. And then you just walked up smelling good, looking good, saved. Now, somebody went to work.
That's right.
Somebody went through some hurt. Great discomfort to pull all of us to get us in the right direction to receive.
That's right.
So that's what Daniel did. He said, I got to know what's going on. And he put himself in that situation where he could hurt. Now, he was, Daniel was in, I don't need to do all this. Politician, I'm living good. Everybody else is messing up. I'm good with the king, So, all right. Verse 4 of item B says, to lift up the spiritual needs of others. Now, that's an important, the spiritual needs of others, Ephesians 1:16. How many of us still got some saved people on our block? You don't go to the same church, but they in your neighborhood. But they don't go to a full gospel church. What are we going to do on Hillsboro's? 1:16, cease not to give thanks for you, make it mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. How much do we really invest in our prayers on behalf of others that they come into revelation, knowledge, understanding, full counsel of God's will, God's word. I mean, you really pour out for your neighbor, neighborhood, co-workers. That's what Paul was saying. You got to pour out for them. Bless Wayne today, Lord. Get them on and off that job. Give them a raise. Amen. Hallelujah. Will that go? Will you get a raise on that one? I'll probably get fired. No, that's not tough enough prayer. Not tough enough prayer. Man, when I was in career, those people prayed. 5 o'clock in the morning was just like 5 o'clock in the afternoon. No biggie. And they walked to prayer. They walked to the Happy Mountain Chapel prayer. No big deal. Those are really Christians. And I was just young in the Lord. I didn't really know the real, you know, I hadn't learned a whole lot, but I could see what they did. That's what they did. No big deal. So when Paul says, I'm praying for others to get revelation knowledge, that's more power in the earth for the will of God. And if you know, you just kind of say, hey, I got it made, me and mine. Okay. Let's go to Philippians 1 and 9. Anybody got to go ahead and read it.
And this I pray, that your love may abound, you said 1 and 9, yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, that you may approve things that are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ.
Amen. And this is what Paul, you know, he prayed it hard for this. He prayed for the development of other believers. And we'll go to Colossians 4 and 12. Ephorias. Ephorias. Can I help you with that? Ephorias.
Where are you?
Verse 4. What's that guy's name?
Ephorias.
Who is one of you, a servant of Christ, salutes you, always laboring. How does he labor?
Fervently.
For you in what? Praise. It will, if Paul says that guy always is working for you in prayer, laboring in prayer, putting it out there. Wow. Why? That you may stand perfect and complete in the will of God. Praying for my welfare. Praying for my benefit. That's how they Paul said, that's how he works. He works hard in prayer. How many like to have a job, prayer job, fill out the application?
Praying for the saints.
You got to be doing it anyway. Huh?
I mean, you have to do it for
your own sake. We have to do it for your own self, but he took it upon himself to pour out for other people in prayer. That's a tough cookie there. He's a tough person. But this is how you are complete, and that's how you know that you're mature, that you can do that. Instead of, and Paul is not saying anything about a crisis driving you into that.
That's true.
It just should be a part, that's part of praying. And we say, and Jesus, when he prayed, did he pray casually?
No.
Or did he really pull out when he went into prayer?
Pull out. Yeah. Sometimes he just done it with a word, and sometimes he had to agonize over it.
Sometimes he agonized, but when we see him and say that he did something with a word,
yeah.
He took
action. He spoke.
Yeah,
yes, he spoke.
He did a deed.
But when he was praying that the cup be removed, that was agony. Now back to what Brother Holman said earlier about the fervency.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's necessarily. I don't think necessarily that. How do I want to put this now? you have to be, something has to happen to you to make it for you to become fervent. But I don't think that. But I do know that things that happen to you will cause you to be fervent.
That is ifs and buts about that.
That will, but I don't think it's necessarily have to. It certainly will.
My question is that when that negative happens and drive you, did it drive, are you in faith or you just got drove because you hurt? Pull the splinter out of me. Pull this nail.
Well,
this,
I
you know what I'm saying? Pull this cactus off of me. You know, help me, Lord. You pull it off. Okay, thank you. Go back doing what you normally do. You pull the hurt off.
I just think about how fervency is used in a positive way. I know we're talking prayer here. But just like for athletes. Okay, athletes use intensity as far as to elevate those with low intensity. So if you say fervency, when I look at an athlete, I'm saying one is more hungrier than the other.
Right.
Or he's more driven than the other.
Right. I think that's the same thing in prayer. Prayer's like that. Some people don't come to prayer very casually and petition God very casually. And the author here in teaching says that you won't get anything like that. Because, as the next verse shows, what God does not tolerate is ineffectiveness.
Lukewarmness.
Yeah, lukewarmness. And he says, I can't deal with that.
That's right.
Yeah. Woo! I can't deal with that. They call midnight prayer. That's what they do over at that church in North Carolina, 46th Street. Midnight prayer. Yeah, I go. It's bad. Flop down. Hallelujah. 1 o'clock, time to go home. Hallelujah.
It's not enough.
What did I just do? Wasted my time and God's time? And God says, I just slap him. God just feel like slapping me.
I can't stay on. I can stay on. That's right.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I think Brother Holman, again, he always bring up these points about how to work the fervency. Pastor always says, because we have lost our sense of need and our first love. And, you know, when you get away from that, then he talks about, and everybody's heard him say this, about, you know, if something happens to your car, to your house, or whatever, you've got insurance, you know, it'll be covered. You know, don't worry about that. But if you didn't have it, then there would be a greater need to seek him for protection.
He used the word seeking.
Yes.
And sometimes it took me a while to understand what the seeking of me. Is that in the Bible? I ain't in the Word. What am I looking for?
I do too.
Seeking him, you got to get a hold of him. And so, you know, when you go into prayer, if you're not there effectively in prayer, God can't stand that. It's disgusting to him. Oh.
And I think a distinction should be made too, at the difference between, say, my fervency, a fervency that I would have, and a fervency that maybe Sister Pearl may have on an individual. Now, she may cry out, and it talks about, and I think it's in Isaiah, about the fervency like you delivering a child. You know, you are getting ready for. Well, now, some people, when they deliver, it's extremely hard. And others say, oh, it was fine. I just had the baby. It wasn't that much of a problem. So I think fervency is an individual kind of thing. And we cannot just pigeonhole and say, if you're not doing this and this and this, you're not fervent. But that fervency has to be coupled with sincerity
and heartfelt.
Exactly.
Right. Let's say that, and the prayer and frequency on the item D on page 10, Frequency is the life and soul of prayer. It is the wing. Fervency. I'm getting tired here, I guess. Oh, man, I can't believe it's 7:25 already.
Wow.
It's the wing on which one's faith ascends to the throne and takes hold of the blessings promise. And that's what you want to do. You want to get into God's attention and lay hold of the promises that he has in his covenant for you. Whatever it might be, Lord, I'm your child, and whatever I'm doing to stay close to poverty, tell me what it is, because this is not supposed to be like this. Now, what does it take for me to get to that job, get to that income, get to that whatever? Reveal it to me. That's how you. That's how I talk to him. Don't want to be broke, don't want to be sick, you said this, that, blah, blah, and all that, in Jesus' name, that's what I'm expecting. He'd probably throw you out of it when I'm talking about that. No, that's what he wants to hear from you. Claim those promises. Somewhere he says, bring it to my attention, remind me of it.
That's right.
Command you me. Yes. Command you me. That's what he wants. Earnest prayer. Okay, man, what happens with the time? I want to look at Jacob on page 11, item 5. And then item 4 says, weak and timid prayers have no power to win marked resorts, nor the ability to succeed against hostile and resisting forces. Then we get to Jacob. Jacob's wrestling all night with the angel gives significant emphasis to the power of perseverance in prayer. I would not let thee go except thou do what?
Bless me.
And this is somebody under the old covenant. You ain't getting out of here, angel, until I get a blessing. And that's how we have to do when we go into prayer. My mind got to be, my total being has to be assured that you heard me and that I addressed you, you heard me, and now I have your word and I'm moving forward. That's how it has to be in prayer. And if you go in and then say, walk out and say, I'm not too sure, I don't know what God's will, I don't know. You got to go back. You got to go back. Now, what makes that easier is that knowing God's will.
Yes.
First of all, because he says, remind me.
Yeah.
Tell me what you're talking about. And then that's what he wants. And so you say, I know what your promise is to me. And what's in the way of coming between, what's keeping it from materializing, manifesting? What is it? And so God will show you. Because he's not to hold back. Okay, let's go into these quick questions right quick. And like on page 13, like brother that's seeking the Lord, can we take 5 minutes extra? Okay, y'all got no pig feet on that.
Wait a minute.
That's okay. Okay. And we talked about Daniel chapter 9 just a little bit, but seeking the Lord, that's something that you should really major in. Verse page 13, 13, page 13. How do I get over personal sins? Uh-oh. How do I get past and get forgiveness personal sins?
First thing you got to acknowledge it and repent. Well, you got to acknowledge that you've sinned, the first thing.
Mm-hmm.
That's the first thing, because okay. A lot of times people just deny, I'm not doing it, and they know they are.
Okay.
But then you got to repent.
Okay.
And the next step is you got to make some kind of retribution, repent, and just turn it around and go a different way.
Okay. Let's read 2 Corinthians 7 and 10, and let's see what Paul says, and then we're going to see what the office is. Make sure they're on the same page. Seven and ten. Okay.
godly sorrow worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of, but the sorrow of the world worketh death.
Right. So, I really don't, sorrow of the world doesn't even compare to godly sorrow. Now, make a note, Psalms 51.
That's David.
That's David. Mm-hmm. And if you read Psalms 51, David was heartbroken.
Oh, yes, he was.
That he broke God's heart.
Exactly.
That's what you call godly sorrow. That I am so sorry that I disappointed God.
Right. And the world's way is like, I made a mistake. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, just forgive me.
Yeah, no. You caught up with me. I'll
forgive you.
Just get
over.
Get over. Let's move on.
Get over. Yeah. And knowing they've hurt you.
Yeah. 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 So now that I have hurt God, disappointed God, how do I get back right with God? Most folks that's hurt, we have to be careful.
You got to confess it.
We got to be careful that we don't hurt God and casually just walk away.
No.
First John 1.
No. Well, you say that. They run that in the ditch.
Should we sing that grace may abound?
God forbid. That's not God.
That's not
okay, William, right here. Okay. Down here at the bottom of page 13, last paragraph.
Okay.
Sin committed by the believer should be reviewed, confessed, mourned, and repented of, one by one, as much as one is able.
Okay.
They should not be glided over and treated casually if godly sorrow is to be experienced.
Okay, godly sorrow is very heavy.
Yes. Self-examination consists of looking at your life, searching your heart, considering your motives and actions, and calling up your past and seeing its true character.
Now, when I first got saved, I didn't experience godly sorrow. Standing right here, 77, 78, I didn't experience no godly sorrow. I heard about what they were saying about Jesus.
That's right.
Hey, I buy that. I like that. And but I did feel like the weight of sin coming off my shoulder, hey, I'm free, I feel good, But I didn't experience godly sorrow. Godly sorrow only happened when you already know the Lord.
And then you transgress. That's right.
Yeah.
Boom.
Yeah.
Boom.
Right.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
And that's what David was trying to figure out. How can I get back? Take not your Holy Spirit
away from me.
I got to get back to you. Renew the right spirit within me. That's David. I got to get back to you. So that's Psalm 51. I can't quote it all right now. But that's when you really know that now that you're in that status, that state, and you godly sorrow, then you repent of it, and then it's over. All right, no more. Don't live it. Don't review it. Don't replay it. Don't reconsider it. Move away from it. And that's what David did with his life. He moved on. And there might have been some circumstances and some trash that followed along, but David went on with the Lord. Some saints mess up with God, and you can't find them with
a certain
Lord, so you can't find them.
And
the devil's killing them with guilt. So godly sorrow can be repented of. I mean, that's what it is. And thank God that he gives you that to make you get back to him. Mm-hmm. Oh, Lord. Okay. But we're not going to have time for the rest of the questions today. I don't think so.
And then we have, different questions. Yeah. Questions are good.
Hopefully everybody got something out of this.
Oh, yeah.
Good hour.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the ocean.
I'm going to go watch